to the nations and do this, baptizing them, discipling them, teaching them. And then he said, after that, he said, but wait. Wait for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Wait to be full of the Spirit. Wait to be filled with the Spirit. Wait for the power from above to come upon you, to clothe you, to endue you with power. Then you will go out as a witness who's got the power of God behind you and within you. Don't just go as a witness unempowered. Go as an empowered witness of Christ. Because there is a huge difference when you witness in these two different ways. If you witness because you're doing out of duty, or when you witness because you are led by the Spirit and empowered by the Spirit of God, it is different. Originally, I wasn't sure if this testimony would be useful for this service, but I think it is now. So I'm going to share with you a testimony. One lady from among you here, last Sunday, after hearing what Pastor Lorna shared about the kingdom come, thy kingdom come, on the way after lunch, saw a man who was sick but was breathless, lying on the ground. There were some people there, and apparently they went to check out, this couple went to check out and found out that they have called the ambulance, and the ambulance was on the way. Most of us would say, good, help is on its way. But led by the Spirit of God, our sister felt that she should lay hands on this man's chest and to pray for healing. And so she did. And she prayed. And he started to breathe slower. Not the dying kind, like, you know. I mean, just relaxing, less anxiety, and breathe normally. And then he sat up and he spoke. That is Spirit-empowered witnessing. I think, if I guess correctly, a lot of us at different times, we would have that leading and prompting to do something of this nature. But most of the time, we chicken out. Because we have the first battle in us, they say, is it me, my flesh, or is it really God? And then usually, you end up thinking, no, like, it's just my thinking, my own imagination. Motivated by fear. What would people think? What if nothing happens? What if I lay hands and pray, he dies? Then they blame me, your hand killed him. How? Honestly, I also don't know how. You know, I mean, but I do know something. If we were to learn to follow the leading of the Spirit on a daily basis, if we were to grow in the Spirit, we would know that it is of God when the Lord speaks. It is only when we're unfamiliar, then suddenly this is like a real quantum leap. But if you're regularly saying, God, what should I do about this? And you listen to Him and then you act over things that will not have devastating effect, then it worked out and you say, that was the Holy Spirit. And then another time you feel like to do something and you do it and it was right. And you say, that was the Holy Spirit. And then another time you say, Lord, should I speak to this person about this? I'm not sure and all that. And the Lord said, go speak to him about it. And then you go and then it was right. And you say, that was the Holy Spirit. And then after a number of times you start to discern the voice of the Spirit. Amen. You start to discern, you start to get familiar with that voice, and then you will know. And then God will take you to the next one. You know, the next thing, the next level is always more challenging. He you're faithful in small things, now he puts you in charge of big things. And then he puts a man on the ground who just had a heart attack in front of you. Or he puts a colleague who's just found out that he has a chronic disease. And you can go pray for the person. What does it take to fulfill the laws and the mandates of the kingdom of God? Now let's now go back to the main text. Today is Matthew 13:44. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in the field, which a man found and hid again. And from joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Verse 45, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking fine pearls. And upon finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. I just found out that this is, verse 45 is actually next Sunday's sermon. So the focus is on the hidden treasure. The hidden treasure here refers to the gospel of the kingdom. That the gospel that we have, that you and I have received, this good news is hidden treasure, is treasure. Now, the hiding part was not meant to be negative. He hid it because he wanted to protect it, to make sure that when he sells everything and comes back to buy it, it's still there. All right? So, you and this treasure refers to the gospel, and you and I are recipients of this gospel. And I don't know if you feel exhilarated and like absolutely amazed and fascinated with the fact that you have received this treasure, that this is our destiny. Do you feel like, wow? How many wow moments? I mean, we get really excited and really thrilled when we move from HDB to condo. And then when we move from condo to a bungalow, we get really thrilled and excited with whole parties and housewarming and this and that, and kind of like just display your beautiful home, your new home. And we're really thrilled. And we get really thrilled when you sell your Proton and finally buy a Toyota. Or you just sold your Toyota and you finally got yourself a Beamer. Or you just sold a Beamer and finally got yourself a Lamborghini. And you're really thrilled, you drive down the road, you feel like on top of the world. Or you just move from a small local accounting firm to one of the big four. And you feel like, wow, you know, I'm going to work today, day one, in Pricey Waterhouse. You know, that's what they call it. But the funny thing is that we're not so thrilled with the fact that we moved from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. I've met Christians who are not so thrilled. Are you thrilled? Are you excited by the fact that we have this great treasure? This great treasure is amazing. The grace of God, the love of God, the mercy of God, the favor of God, the blessing of God, the protection that comes from Him is absolutely amazing. Amazing. Say amazing. Amazing. And so this man, he found the treasure, he hid it, and he went back and he sold all in order to buy the field that had the treasure, right? So there was a requirement. The requirement was for him to sell all in order to gain the treasure. And the next part, of course, verse 45, to sell all to gain the pearl of great value. And so we have found this treasure, the kingdom of heaven. You see, this parable is interesting. There was the discovery of something that's available to the man, a great treasure available, but then he had to do something. He had to sell all to get it. Likewise, what Jesus was saying, kingdom of heaven, he said, kingdom of heaven is like this. So Jesus was trying to teach us a lesson. The kingdom of heaven is like this. So it's the same. The gospel of the kingdom is great treasure, but there's a requirement. There's a requirement. In order to gain the kingdom of heaven, we have to live as citizens of the kingdom, obey the mandates of the kingdom. That's the requirement. You cannot have a citizen or a passport that says citizen of the kingdom of heaven and then you live like an ungodly person. You live like you just don't represent Jesus in any way, the way you live, the way I live. If that happens, the passport is taken away. If that happens, the passport is taken away. We have to live according to the kingdom laws. The kingdom of God is not just about receiving something from God, but living as a representative of our King, as an ambassador of the kingdom. That's why we are called, what do we call? Christians.